Hello everyone, my name is Shireen, and it's my pleasure to speak to you today on professionalism and ethics. To give you a bit of background on myself, I completed my MBBS and general surgery postgraduate training in UM, after which I trained in pediatric surgery at the Pediatric Institute HKL. I then spent 10 years abroad in London and Singapore before returning to UM. Through my many moves, I had the opportunity to experience firsthand how these concepts of professionalism and ethics played out in a variety of cultures and environments. From barbers and butchers to modern surgeons, how far we have come to today's skilled and respected surgical community, much of it due to an expected code of professional conduct. All developed surgical training programs have professionalism as a core competency in training, recognizing that failures in this area lead to detrimental outcomes for patients, while a strong culture of professionalism improves patient safety and the healthcare work environment. Previous models of training focused on knowledge gathering and the development of technical skills, with professionalism and ethics taught through the apprenticeship model. Many now recognize that this is not good enough. So let's start with some definitions of professionalism. For something that is recognized as an essential area of development in a surgeon, there is no agreed single definition. A number of surgical associations have developed their own definitions. For example, in the Annals of the Royal College of Surgeons of England, professionalism, in relation to surgical practice, incorporates competence, consistency, honesty, and integrity. Surgeons have a responsibility to maintain the highest level of public trust and confidence in the profession. Another author in the Australia and New Zealand Journal of Surgery said that the moral, cognitive, and collegial aspects of practice form professionalism. For example, putting patients first, managing conflicts of interest, honesty and confidentiality, disclosing errors, self-regulation, and advocacy. Let's look at what some of the characteristics of professional behavior are. Competent, available, punctual, good listener, respectful, communicative, empathetic, reassuring, personally responsible, well illnesses and problems all addressed, copes with stress, self-aware, able to get along with others. What an incredible list of characteristics. Do we think surgeon when we read this list? Putting definitions aside, unfortunately, rightly or wrongly, surgeons have a reputation for unprofessional behavior. We know it when we see it, and we have all seen it in wards, in the operating theatre, in patient-surgeon interactions, in the dynamics between a superior and someone lower down the chain of hierarchy. It is often tolerated as, that's just how it is. Even worse, we unwittingly reward it. How many times have we seen nurses scurry to fulfill a difficult surgeon's request, thus reinforcing the idea that you have to be nasty to get things done? Whether consciously or not, the conduct of surgeons influences how trainees act and behave with colleagues and their patients. Unprofessional behavior is contagious. Conversely, can we then make professional and ethical behavior contagious? Can we affect culture change? I believe we can. I would like to use this definition to unpack the concept of professionalism. A set of values, behaviors, and relationships that underpins the trust the public has in its doctors. Incorporates competence, consistency, autonomy, honesty, and integrity, and should be reflected in actions, work, speech, dress, and behavior. Let's start with competence, the basis of every surgical or medical training program. Competence is the key standard in professionalism. It is a set of demonstrable characteristics and skills that enable and improve the efficiency or performance of a job. Both knowledge and skill must be demonstrated with the emphasis on patient safety. Accordingly, standards must be established and maintained. Surgeons must keep up to date and maintain professional education and skill. Surgeons should not operate outside their safe sphere of competence. What action do we need to take to maintain competence? Regular reflection and appraisal of one's own clinical practice. A willingness to perform clinical audit. Do not be afraid to discuss both good and bad outcomes. Participation in continuing professional development, and the willingness to engage in lifelong learning. Some of the most respected senior surgeons I know demonstrate this with humility and an eternal curiosity. Next, let's talk about consistency. Consistency is hitting the target every time. Consistency is what transforms average into excellence. This can be in the technical skills, so that outcomes are predictable and reliable. Reliably good, of course. But beyond that is consistency of attitude and behavior, of conduct. Nobody wants to work with a temperamental surgeon whose mood fluctuates dramatically, who is unpredictable, who may flare up in anger or laugh for reasons nobody can really understand. What about autonomy? Autonomy of both patient and physician have to be balanced. The patient has a right to make decisions about their medical care without their healthcare provider trying to influence the decision. This is not easy. Everything we say, to various extent, influences patients. But the patient must always feel the freedom to make decisions without coercion or judgment. We also need to recognize that the physician requires autonomy to act in good conscience and to do their best for their patients. Physician autonomy is the freedom to determine both the conditions of practice and the care delivered with the principal goal that care decisions are aimed at promoting the patient's well-being. For example, a trainee should be able to make the clinical decisions they feel are best for a patient rather than prioritizing the feelings of a consultant over that of a patient. And what about honesty? How do we encourage honesty? This is especially challenging in our society. We value saving face. We value respect for elders or seniors or teachers. Honesty does not mean being rude, but it does mean sometimes being willing to be unpopular. To be the person who is willing to give a poor trainee evaluation when you honestly feel that their performance is not up to par and that pushing them through may result in a surgeon who is detrimental to patient safety. This cartoon, I believe, shows a false dichotomy. I believe that it is possible to be both honest and truthful, but with compassion and concern. As the song goes, a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down, but the medicine has to go down. And then we come to integrity. Integrity is doing the right thing even when no one is watching. A quote from one of my favorite authors. If we want to encourage integrity and openness, we must cultivate a culture of no blame, where all feel free to speak without fear of reprisal, while maintaining professional courtesy at all times. We ourselves, as supervisors, as trainers, have to role model this behavior by being open with our own mistakes and shortcomings and encouraging others to provide feedback. Wise words indeed. To err is human, but to cover up is unforgivable, and to fail to learn is inexcusable. Finally, professionalism should be reflected in actions, work, speech, dress, and behavior. These are the ways that the values of professionalism are displayed in day-to-day encounters. Although recent changes in training appear to lessen the apprentice nature within surgery, it is still a profession whereby trainees largely learn by example. As such, it is important to recognize disruptive behavior, especially in ourselves as trainers, in order that we may role model the right behavior. Disruptive behavior has been defined as personal conduct, whether verbal or physical, that negatively affects or that potentially may negatively affect patient care. For example, inappropriate language or behavior, profane, disrespectful language, demeaning behavior such as name-calling, sexual comments, innuendo, inappropriate touching, sexual or otherwise, racial or ethnic jokes, uncontrolled anger, outbursts of anger including throwing instruments, charts or other objects, negative talk, personal criticism of doctors, nurses, even institutions, in front of patients or staff, criticizing other caregivers in front of patients or other staff, or making comments that undermine a patient's trust in other caregivers or the hospital. As supervisors and trainers, we need to nip these behaviors in the bud before they take root. So how do we recognize early signs of lapses in professionalism? There might be poor handover between both junior and senior staff, and this occurs when individuals have difficulty communicating or are aggrieved. There may be poor meeting discipline. You may see a lack of preparation, absenteeism, chronic latism, high sickness rates or absence rates, individuals arriving either late or not showing up at all for a teaching session with no apology, playing off one against another, or regular criticism of professional opinion, especially in public. It is a source of concern and embarrassment for junior witnesses to such incidences. Refusal to cover for other members of the team or to work with specific individuals. Let's circle back now to this list of positive characteristics that we all should emulate and practice in an intentional and purposeful manner to develop a workplace culture that produces well-balanced surgeons focused on patient care. We also need to talk about the concept of ethics in surgery, which is closely related to professionalism. Ethics in surgery is the application of ethics to situations that are specific to surgical practice. And the core of surgical ethics is the surgeon-patient relationship and the surgeon's responsibility to advance and protect the well-being of the patient. Many of you may already be familiar with these four core principles of medical ethics. Autonomy appears again, the patient's capacity for self-determination to make independent decisions. Beneficence, the concept where the patient's welfare is paramount. Non-maleficence, the obligation not to inflict harm, or more well known in the phrase, first, do no harm. Justice, the idea of equal access to healthcare for all. Now, how do we transfer these concepts of ethics to our day-to-day practice? With autonomy, the patient must be adequately informed about the benefits and risks of the proposed surgical treatment. The patient has the right to decide whether or not to accept treatment, and a competent patient has the right to refuse treatment after adequate information, even when this refusal would lead to his or her death. In surgery, this autonomy must be respected in taking informed consent for surgical procedures. Beneficence. Surgeons have the obligation to maximize potential benefits for their patients while at the same time minimizing potential harm for them. The patient must not be deceived. In non-maleficence, if the risks and burdens of a given surgery for a specific patient outweigh the potential benefits, then the surgeon has an obligation not to operate. We call this futile surgery, where risks to the patient outweigh the benefits, and this should not be performed even if the patient requests for it. And then justice, the idea that there should be equal access to healthcare for all, that every patient is entitled to obtain the best surgical care available within the resources available in their environment. Expensive surgery should always, like any other therapy, be provided solely when indicated. That undertreatment should not be the result of containing the growing cost of healthcare, and that patients have the right to have their health valued more highly than the surgeon's own economic interests. Thank you very much for your time and listening to me. I hope you enjoy the rest of the course.